Greetings from CNS. Welcome everyone to this very special webinar in the lead up to two milestone global conferences on AIDS and tuberculosis, which will be held one after the other at the same venue in Durban, South Africa, just this month. Holding two international conferences on AIDS and TB at the same venue, one following the other, is not only maximization of resources, but also will help galvanize TB-HIV collaborative activities. Before we get started, let me make a few quick announcements. All participants are requested to please send us your questions while the panelists present. No need to wait. Just type your questions using the chat function or raise your virtual hand. You will see on your computer screen during the question and answer session. I also request all panelists to please present in time so that we have good enough time left for question and answers. Thanks for your cooperation. Without any further ado, let me invite our first panelist. Since Dr. Fuad is there, Dr. Fuad, would you like to present first?
Yes, of course.
So we have with us Dr. Fuad Mirzayev, Medical Officer, Laboratories, Diagnostics, and Drug Resistance Unit at the WHO Global TB Program. Welcome, Dr. Fuad. Before we begin, I would just like to mention that South Africa has experienced both TB and HIV epidemics in alarming proportions. It is among the high burden countries for TB, and TB incidence shot up by 400% in the last 15 years. I'm talking of South Africa because the two conferences are being held there. And out of the 450,000 TB cases in South Africa, it is estimated that about 60% of these people have both HIV and TB. According to WHO globally, in 2014, there were 9.6 million new cases of TB, of which 1.2 million were among people living with HIV. So now, over to our first key expert who will brief us on about TB and HIV collaborations and other things. Over to you, Dr. Fuad.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to share my screen, and I hope you can see the presentation now.
Yes, we can see.
Great. So in this short presentation, I will try to provide an overview of the WHO recent WHO recommendations on shorter MDR-TB regimen. And so it came out, this recommendation, in the updated WHO treatment guidelines for drug-resistant TB. And it is important probably to say that although this presentation is focused on the shorter regimen, it's not the only change from the previous 2011 guidelines of WHO on drug-resistant, on management of drug-resistant tuberculosis that came out. There are other new recommendations besides the recommendation on the shorter regimen. For example, there is the change in the classification of the different second line anti-TB medicines that in the table with classification of these medicines, there is a change in the gradation. And for example, the clofazimine and linezolid, the two drugs that were in the previous group 5 are now recommended as core second-line medicines in MDR-TB regimen, while, for example, PAS, paraaminosalicylic, is put into the so-called add-on agent. In addition, the MDR-TB treatment is now recommended to all patients with rifampicin-resistant tuberculosis, regardless if the isoniazid resistance is confirmed or not. There are new recommendations that are made on the treatment of children with rifampicin-resistant or MDR-TB, and also there is a first time that some evidence-informed recommendations are available in these guidelines on the role of surgery as well. Talking about the policy formulation process, and I think it is important to highlight that. And these couple of slides will be on how WHO comes up with its recommendations. It's based on certainly another guideline that we have in WHO on development on guidelines and the handbook that is also available online. The policy formulation uses it's a multi-step process that starts with the member states, partner agencies proposing or with just this proposing the new evidence or when evidence is available and suggest the need for the new policy or the policy change. The policy development involves a review of available evidence, often through a systematic review of available data. Review of data and translation of it into decisions is done by the expert group, which is an expert group usually constituted with the broad constituencies and convened by WHO. And the evidence, the quality, the strength are evaluated using a great process for evidence synthesis. WHO formulates policy statements, then that these statements are submitted to the Guideline Review Committee for compliance with WHO requirements before being disseminated to the member states, with plans for promotion with stakeholders and funders, as well as a plan for phased implementation and scale-up. The grade evaluation takes into account, besides of the evidence and the quality of it, it also takes into account the patient values and preferences, the balance between benefits, harms, and burden, and also considers the use of resources. The usual cycle for guideline review nowadays with WHO is about 3 to 5 years when based on the new available evidence, the guidelines are usually renewed. It is important also to understand the implications and of strength of recommendation for different users and what these recommendations mean. Following the great process of development, the guidelines, when they are strong recommendation or conditional, it has a big meaning. For example, from the patient's perspective, the strong recommendation would mean that most of the patients in the situation described or situation that recommendation covers would want the recommended course of action, and only a small proportion would not. So while in the other case with the conditional recommendation, that means the majority of individuals would want the suggested course of action, but many as well would not. So the conditionality that is always marked next to the WHO recommendations means a lot, as well as the certainty of evidence or the strength of the evidence that is also mentioned as high, moderate, low, or very low. With a high strength of evidence, it is very clear that the research and evidence is so clear that further research is unlikely to change the confidence in the estimate of the effect. While with the moderate and low, it is clear that the further research will have either quite important impact on the confidence in the estimate of the effect. And when it is very low, it is actually reflects the doubts with which the panel and subsequently the WHO has made that recommendation. Coming back to the shorter regimens, and looking back into the history of WHO position on the shorter regimen, it is important to note that while the evidence was being collected, these regimens were encouraged to be used in well-organized operational research conditions. This is a snapshot of the website that recommended certain conditions for this in WHO. Now, with the recommendations, these regimens are actually one of the possible regimens for MDR-TB, so the operational research conditions are not required anymore. But the use of the shorter regimen was limited to the certain parts of the world, and therefore the evidence can you see this slide? I'm sorry.
Yes, okay. We can. Yes.
Okay.
Can.
No. Looks okay now. So the use of the short regimen was limited to the certain countries that are put on this map. The evidence that comes out that led to the WHO recommendation is also has these projects in those countries in the background. We are hoping very much that the new evidence and the high quality evidence from the clinical trial that is currently running and managed by the union, so-called STREAM trial, on which Dr. I.D. Rusan presented in the last webinar, I think, those interested could check back the recording of that webinar for more details. The evidence that led to the recommendation was not abundant. It is important to say it was based on the meta-analysis of shorter MDR-TB regimens in 1,205 patients in these specific countries, in Bangladesh, Benin, Burkina Faso, Burundi, Cameroon, Central African Republic, DR Congo, Niger, Swaziland, and Uzbekistan. The treatment success rates were quite high, as reported in this group of patients, reaching about on average 84%, which when compared with the group that were on the conventional MDR-TB regimen, the treatment success was much higher. So 84% versus 62% in a comparable selection of MDR patients. In patients who did not complete treatment successfully, 7% died, 6% were lost to follow-up, and 3% had a treatment failure, which something notable here is that the very low proportion of patients who were lost to follow-up, that probably has to do with the fact that this regimen is much shorter. It's actually about the half of the conventional MDR-TB regimen. The relapse was also assessed in the studies reviewed, and there were not many patients that relapsed after that treatment. So basically that led to the following recommendation on the shorter MDR-TB regimen, where in patients with rifampicin-resistant TB or MDR-TB who have not been previously treated with second-line drugs and in whom resistance to quinolones and second-line injectable agents have been excluded or considered highly unlikely, there is a recommendation to use the shorter MDR-TB regimen of 11 months instead of conventional regimen. Please note that this is the conditional recommendation and with a very low certainty in the evidence, as referring to that couple of slides that I presented earlier. The shorter regimen is a standardized package with very limited modifications permissible because the evidence that presented is based on the very standardized package of medicines with the 4 to 6 month of kanamycin, moxifloxacin, proteanamide, clofazimine, pyrazinamide, and high dose isoniazid coupled with ethambutol and with the 5 further months excluding the injectable without isoniazid and proteanamide. This recommendation applies to the adults, children, and people living with HIV. It is important and strongly recommended that patients are tested with the DST, drug susceptibility testing, for fluoroquinolones and second-line injectable medicines. The cost of this regimen is significantly lower than of the conventional regimen, just simply and mainly because the duration is much shorter. And although the monitoring for effectiveness of the regimen, relapse and harms, still has to follow the same advice on the active TB drug safety monitoring and management. And again, just to reiterate that the results of the STREAM trial are very much, we are looking forward for these results to update and improve this recommendation. The simple steps when choosing the treatment regimen in patients with confirmed rifampicin resistance and MDR-TB, one should exclude the resistance or suspected ineffectiveness to the medicines in the shorter regimen, most importantly for quinolones and injectables. There should be no documented intolerance to one or more medicines in the shorter regimen or risk of toxicity, and as the evidence has not supplied any information on the use of these regimens in pregnant women and with extrapulmonary disease, it is suggested to exclude both the pregnancy and extrapulmonary TB. And then the shorter regimen can be prescribed and patients followed. In any other case, when one of these conditions apply, it is advised to put the patient on individualized conventional MDR-TB regimen. So with that short overview, I would like to conclude and we'll be happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Dr. Fuad Mirzayev, a very important presentation, and also to let us know what goes behind the scene before WHO comes up with a recommendation, and no wonder we take it as the gospel truth. I would also now like to hand over to Mr. Ashok Ramsarup, who has just joined us, and he is our chief moderator. I was just doubling up for him till now. And so I would request Ashok Ramsarup to introduce our next panelist from the union.
Sure. Greetings from Durban, South Africa, International TB Conference and 21st International AIDS Conference. Both will be held in Durban from the 16th July onwards. South Africa has experienced both epidemics in alarming proportions, TB and HIV, in the past few decades. It is among the high burden countries for TB, and TB incidence shot up by 400% in the last 15 years. Out of the 450,000 TB cases in South Africa, it is estimated that about 60% of these people have both HIV and TB. The latest figures from the South African Department of Health is that 73% of TB patients are HIV positive. According to the World Health Organization globally, in 2014, there were 9.6 million new cases of TB, of which 1.2 million were among people living with HIV. Today, in the webinar, we have key experts who will brief us and help us report to in the lead up to two major global conferences on TB and HIV, which begins later this week in Durban. Let me introduce the panel of experts right now. It's Nomampondo Barnabas, Civil Society Liaison Officer at the International Union Against Tuberculosis and Lung Disease, or the union based in Johannesburg, South Africa. She has a wealth of experience on both TB and HIV. She's locally and internationally recognized for her efforts in fighting stigma and discrimination against infected and affected communities. She is committed to provide the voice of the voiceless. Today, she is bringing to this webinar a patient's perspective, sharing her experience of living with both diseases. We now bring you Nomampondo Barnabas. It's over to Noma.
So I think she will be there in a moment. Noma, so can you hear us?
Yes, in the meantime, our panel, just for our panel, maybe they can answer a very short question, the difference between TB and AIDS. Just a brief answer.
I think Noma is having some problems with the internet connection. So Ashok, could you introduce Dr. Sachdeva? I think he can present, and no one can later on. So.
Oh, great. Okay, that'd be great. We now move straight over to Dr. K.S. Sachdeva, Deputy Director General of National AIDS Control Organization, NACO, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Dr. Sachdeva, as many of us know, have also been instrumental for several years in shaping and strengthening national TB program in India, and now he's leading India's national AIDS program. It is no surprise how TB and HIV collaborative activities are going to get stronger in India under his leadership. It's now over to you, Dr. Sachdeva. Can you hear me, Dr. Sachdeva?
I can hear you, but
I think he's there. It is very feeble. Doctor, we can hear you, but it is feeble. Although we can hear you feebly. Yes. We can hear you.
Okay. So, yes. Could I share my screen now? So Shobha, can you see the screen now, which I'm sharing?
Yes.
Yes, I can see the screen.
Yes.
Okay, sure. Okay, good. So what I'm going to talk about is the TB-HIV collaborative activities in general and in particular with reference to my country, which is India. So just to give you brief about the estimates of the burden of TB-HIV. So, India is a TB burden country. We are not a high HIV burden country. But when it comes to absolute numbers, we are considered in absolute numbers. We are also considered a high HIV burden country in absolute numbers. In ratios, we may be a low prevalent country. And so, similarly, the co-infection rate in India is considered to be very high. And we estimate about 110,000 cases emerging every year who are TB-HIV co-infected. And of them, we expect about 31,000 deaths within them. The detection rate in the country currently for TB-HIV patients is low, which is about 45,000 patients are detected to have the dual infection and are put on treatment, of whom under the program about 6,000 are reported deaths. Now, a brief about the performance of TB-HIV in the country. I'm not going into the other details of epidemiology. It's about how the program is doing. So if we see the number of TB patients who know their HIV status in India is about 85% of them know their HIV status, as compared to about 50 to 60% globally. So the collaboration is working well here. Similarly, the number of HIV-infected patients, TB-HIV-infected patients who receive cotrimoxazole preventive therapy is close to 95%. Similarly, the patients, co-infected patients who ultimately get antiretroviral therapy is also close to 95%. So these three components of the program are working well. Having said that, there are a few issues also which I will talk later. The main challenges which we face in our country is that it's not a single, being such a huge country with a population of roughly 130 billion, it's not a single generalized epidemic setting which we can consider. And also the performance amongst various territories varies considerably. So when we say 95% have access to antiretroviral therapy, 85% know about their HIV status, so there are states and districts which report as low as 43% of patients knowing HIV status versus few states reporting as 100%. So this is three for all the three parameters which I just discussed, which is about patients knowing their HIV status, also the patients who are subsequently put on ART, and the patients who get cotrimoxazole preventive therapy. So one of the main features of this wide variation in performance is also about the availability of services for HIV as well as for TB. So the availability of service for testing for TB-HIV co-infected patients, we look at how many places in the country have these services which are just next door. So while majority of the country has a co-location of testing facilities, but if you look at the map, the states which you see in yellow and some in the red have a co-location which is less than desirable. So that's also responsible for a variable program performance across various states and districts. Having said that, we are working towards a 100% co-location between the TB testing facilities and the HIV testing facilities. So like this graph shows the number of HIV patients, TB-HIV patients who are receiving cotrimoxazole preventive therapy. So you look at it varies from 0 to 100%. So there are states like Jammu and Kashmir, Arunachal Pradesh, and Lakshadweep, where there is a 0% of patients, hardly any patient is receiving the cotrimoxazole preventive therapy, to the states like Andaman, Nicobar, Dadra, Nagar Haveli, where 100% of patients receive. So this is one of the big challenge to ensure uniform availability of services, uptake of services, and also that patient access services uniformly throughout the country. So this graph shows you about the availability of antiretroviral therapy to TB-HIV co-infected patients. Again, here you see the range is from 0 to 100% the range. The average being more than 90%, but still there are pockets where you need to do a lot. Coming specifically to issues of children, specifically with TB-HIV, the challenge in children specifically for both the diseases is what is the appropriate, while we know the appropriate sample for HIV, in TB getting an appropriate sample proves to be very challenging. So reaching a conclusive diagnosis of tuberculosis in children is difficult because of the issues related to the appropriate sample. Also there are issues related to the screening of children for TB as well as HIV. So while we use the four symptom complex to rule out TB, still, again, as said, it's not uniformly happening across the country. The another big challenge is tracing of childhood contacts of patients, adult patients who have pulmonary TB, and then linking children with the antiretroviral therapy and anti-tuberculosis therapy, and it, this is irrespective of the CD4 count of the patient. Another big challenge is the impaired immunity, specifically due to undernutrition or malnutrition, which is quite predominant among children, under 5 children in the country. So what is the way ahead in TB-HIV collaborative activities? So the country has taken a number of policy initiatives, the foremost being we have introduced, we said for all children, we will use rapid diagnostics. So no children will be subjected to a low sensitive sputum smear microscopy for diagnosis of their TB. All children will be subjected to gene expert testing for early diagnosis of TB, and also if they have additional resistance to rifampicin, that will be addressed too. So this is one policy decision which is taken by the country and is being currently implemented across all over the country. The second policy decision is to go for intensified case finding activity across all HIV care settings. So all HIV patients across all HIV care settings, whenever they visit the HIV care facilities, are screened for 4 symptom complex, and then if screened positive for any of one of the 4 symptoms, they are then linked to a testing which is preferably a molecular based testing. And all, again, the another policy is that all HIV positive patients have to be tested on the rapid molecular test, which is a gene expert. Again, we are we have advised all government, state government, district governments that they should prioritize gene expert testing over sputum smear microscopy, which will be more challenging in HIV positive patients because of their low sputum smear positivity. So that's another key policy decision which is taken. So one key policy decision is use of gene expert in children. Other key expert policy decision is use of gene expert in HIV positive patients, irrespective of whether it's a suspect of for a drug sensitive TB or a drug resistant TB. So it's a universal availability of gene expert for this subgroup of population. And all ART centers in the country have been now linked with the availability of gene experts. So, approximately 80 odd districts which do not have linkages, we are working towards establishing those linkages. So which means almost 90 to 95% of HIV positive patients have now linkages to rapid molecular testing. The another policy initiative which we have taken in the TB-HIV co-infected patients is that having noted that the mortality continued to remain high in such TB-HIV co-infected patients, and having seen through the systematic analysis and other research reports that daily regimen for such subgroup of patients can reduce mortality, we have rolled out fixed dose daily anti-tuberculosis therapy in all TB-HIV co-infected patients, currently being implemented in high load settings and being scaled up to the entire country. Within the usage of daily therapy in TB-HIV co-infected patients for TB treatment, we have also introduced information and communication based technology solutions to see that supplement the directly observed treatment. So to make DOT more patient friendly, we have introduced what we call as 99 dots, where once you take a drug pill, a mobile number appears in behind the pill box. You have to just give a missed call to that number, which is a proxy indicator of patient having consumed the anti-TB drugs. And this is called 99% 99 dots because 99 times when a person makes such a missed call, it can be presumed that he has actually consumed those anti-TB drugs. The one issue where the program is still lagging behind is the provision of INH prophylactic therapy to TB-HIV co-infected patients. Despite this being a policy for past few years, the challenge here was making the availability of INH, the procurement proved to be a little challenging, which we have finalized just now, but it did prove to be challenging in the last 2 to 3 years. So country is still to roll out INH prophylactic therapy. Having said that, on the sound evidence that we will have soon have the availability of INH prophylactic therapy, the drugs availability in the next 3 months, the country has already started initiated the training on rolling out of IPT, and we have almost covered half of the country with those trainings. Another very good policy initiative which the national country has taken is to implement airborne infection control measures at all TB care settings and all HIV care settings. So these measures are being implemented in the entire country. We are implementing all the three measures, which is the basic administrative controls, the personal protective measures, and also the environmental controls. So we are progressing the way we should be progressing in TB-HIV to infected patients with a host of new policy initiatives. The one which just remains to be implemented is the INH prophylactic therapy, and I can say it with the confidence that within next quarter we'll roll out that INH prophylactic therapy also. So I thank you all for being with me, and we'll be happy to take further questions and queries.
Thank you very much, Dr. K.S. Sachdeva, Deputy Director General of National AIDS Control Organization, NACO, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Thank you very much for an inspiring speech. It's now over to Madam Shoba.
Thank you, Dr. Sachdeva, and I just want to repeat that with Dr. Sachdeva there at NACO, we really hope and we are in fact rather sure that things would improve still more in India on TB-HIV collaborative activities. Now we will begin the question and answer session. Participants, please keep sending your questions using the chat function or raise your virtual hand, which you will see on the screen. We already have a few questions. Sandeep Meherwal from Indonesia wanted to ask a question. Sandeep, would you like to ask the question yourself?
Hello, my question Sandeep, is to Dr. Sachdeva.
Yes,
yeah, please go on.
Sir. Dr. Sachdeva. Dr. Sachdeva, thank you for an excellent talk. I just wanted to know about your mechanism of specimen transportation. How will you manage with only 121 machine the access of gene expert to all the HIV and childhood TB cases?
So, thank you so much. We had 121 machines about a few years back. Now we have close to 700 gene expert machines in the country. Just now procured about 6 months ago 500 additional machines under the program. So as I alluded to in my talk, out of 700 districts in the country, 620 have CBNAT. We have this gene expert machine in each district. Rest 80 we will transport specimen either through courier, which can be a postal courier, a business courier company, or through a human courier like we have done very successfully in the program which is called Programmatic Management of Drug Resistant TB. So we have good experience with the specimen transportation system. It worked out very well in the PMDT program, and it's actually eased out a bit because now we have close to 700 gene expert machines which are available in the country.
Okay, thank you. And I would just like to have an interruption here. Noma had earlier said, Noma from the union, she had said that perhaps she has to rush for a meeting, but somehow she has managed to get some time for us. So I would request Ashok Ramsurup to introduce Noma quickly, and then she can speak.
Sure. Where is that? Okay, he's coming through. Actually, we got one of our sisters from South Africa. We bring to you a very important guest, Nomampondo Barnabas, civil society liaison officer based in Johannesburg, South Africa. She has a wealth of experience on both TB and HIV. She is locally and internationally recognized for her efforts in fighting stigma and discrimination against infected and affected communities. She's committed to provide the voice of the voiceless. Right now, she brings to this distinguished webinar the patient's perspective, sharing her experience of living with both diseases. It's now over to Norma. She'll probably give us an in-depth knowledge of what's happening.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Hello. Oh, can hear me now. Even the first time I was online, but I could hear you properly, but you couldn't hear me. Thank you for the opportunity, and thank you for the powerful introduction. And I think it was by coincidence that was not able to join initially, because I always like to speak last after hearing all the data and the evidence from the medical Yes, expects. Hence, I'm bringing a different perspective into the whole program of addressing the co-epidemics. Am I still clear?
Yes.
Hello? Oh, yes. Okay, all right. As I said, that I'm bringing in personal experience on the two epidemics. I was diagnosed with HIV in 1997. And as we all know, and having heard the doctors sharing their experiences and the data from their day-to-day of dealing with people living with HIV, and we know that somewhere, somehow, with HIV advancing, one of the leading opportunistic infections is TB. And I happen to be diagnosed with TB in 2006. And the first doctor who presented the WHO guidelines indicated the importance of shortened regimens, because by that time, if you were to think in 2006, by that time, because of my weight, I had to take 5 TB drugs, I had to take 5 ARVs, I had to take 2 antibiotics to prevent further infections. I was also on pyridoxine to prevent side effects, which is your pins and needles on the feet and hands. So for me, really, I'm bringing the importance of research to looking at shorter regimens to decrease pill burden, because that is why we end up with treatment fail defaulters, because it's too much. Well, fortunately, now I'm only on 1 pill per day, which is fine. But it really would be nice in the future if one can, as researchers are working, I know I come from the research field before joining the union. The researchers are working tirelessly. They work overnight to come up with better regimens. But we also need to look at finding shorter regimens for TB. We need to look at fixed dose for TB. Who knows, one day even a fixed combination or a combination that will address both TB and HIV. When it comes to childhood TB, it's just alarming, because really those kids are struggling, and the taste of those drugs, they would have to crush and put into water. It's such a struggle for parents. So I always put the voice of the voiceless, because most people living with this co-epidemics, they never get to the platforms such like this. And I'm happy that CNS is leading this process, because again, it's important to work with the media so that when they present on facts, and when they present on positive findings as well as putting the human face. we've had the data, we've had the figures, but at the end of the day, we need human face to say, those data are from human, and these are the people living with the epidemics. And with concentrated efforts, we will be able to come up with conducive and enabling and accepting environment for them to minimize stigma and discrimination against them. I was going to be very brief, as I say that I really just wanted to put forward those issues forward to researchers and WHO and media. For me.
Thank you, Norman. Thank you very much for emphasizing upon
hello.
The human face. Hello. Norma has emphasized so very clearly.
Yes,
the
I'm still
human
on that.
Face of yes, please go on. Yes, Norma, you can continue, please.
Are there questions for me?
Yeah, we will get to the question. Before that, let me thank you for your presentation. Your voice is central to not just this webinar, but also to both TB and HIV policies and programs. Thank you once again, and we'll let you know questions are coming there. Zulfia Tilo from Kazakhstan wanted to ask a question. Zulfia, would you like to ask a question? Zulfia, can you hear me?
Hello.
Meanwhile, we have a question.
Oh,
yes.
Can I pose a question?
Did the question come through? You okay? Yes.
Yes, please ask. Yes. Ashok, you wanted to ask the question.
Yes, lovely. I will. Actually, to what extent education is playing in the fight against TB and HIV? Because most times you'll find the rich obviously get to know first, they say, but we want to know something about people from disadvantaged communities. There is a total lack of education, and they need to be told more about TB and HIV. You want something to them. You want something to know about this. From the experts?
Can I respond to Can I respond to that?
Yes.
Yes, please.
All right. I might be speaking in English and having this opportunity of being a consultant, a civil society for the union, but I consider myself coming from the disadvantage because I don't have any medical background. The only time I switched over to this field is was after I was diagnosed and experienced discrimination at work. And that is when we decided to stand up and raise discrimination and stigma against people living with HIV. So I come from disadvantage. Yes, I might have moved myself up the ladder, but my background is disadvantage. And it's easy for me to even reach out to any part of the world, to any part of my country, rich or poor, because they can relate better with me.
In terms of AIDS and TB education at school level?
Okay, in terms of reaching out to the population, as I say that, my previous experience was working with the researchers. I come from Caprice and UKZN, and I've been with the Perinatal HIV Research Unit in Soweto. And my role in any part of research has been about community engagement. I represent the voice and pushing for the importance of civil society engagement, hence even with the union, that is my role. In a more meaningful in a more meaningful and participatory approach instead of speaking on behalf of or imposing to them. Whatever programs will come up, they should be responding to the needs of the patients.
Great. Thank you for that in-depth.
Thank you. We have Arthit Har, a senior journalist from India, who wants to ask a question. Arthi, you can ask your question. Arthi? Arthi wants to know if TB can still be described as a poor man's disease. Is it still a poor man's disease? And Dr. says they would like to answer that.
So, Shobha, there is a misconception that TB is a poor man's disease. It used to be a poor man's disease. It still is a poor man's disease to some extent because most of the drivers of the epidemic are, say, overcrowding, lack of ventilation. So if a person is infected, you are in a very, very close contact with that person, you have more chance of getting TB. Having said that, what we are seeing currently is that we see now patients from all walks of society. Very, very rich patients, I don't wish to name them, but very, very rich patients, celebrities also are suffering from TB, suffered from TB, and specifically the new variants of TB, which is the drug-resistant TB, you are seeing across all strata of the society. So what used to be a poor man's disease still is largely a poor man's disease, but the message should not go here that it is only a poor man's disease. It is being seen in a good proportion in a rich strata of the society also, and they all need to take care of that, even that strata of society. Am I clear, or you need some further elaboration?
I think it's poverty exacerbates the disease. It's just, but because TB anywhere is everywhere. This is what, no, it is an airborne, at least 100 TB is an airborne infection. So we are breathing the same air. So perhaps it's a different way, body may be reacting in a different way. But as you said, it can strike anyone, rich or poor, doesn't matter. Thank you. We have to remove people from...
So the basic message is if you are breathing, you can get...
Yes, I think so. This is the message I get. We have to remove people from the newspaper who wants to know that while the world is striving towards zero AIDS discrimination...
Hello? Shaka?
Go ahead. I didn't get the question very clearly.
Yes, please repeat the question. Hello, Shaka?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Ken? Yes, sorry, I had lost my connectivity.
Yes, there was the last question about discrimination, it was not clear.
We can bet on it. I am doing fine here.
Last session.
No. Hello.
Yeah, go ahead. I can hear you. I don't know whether Shobha can hear you or Ashok can hear you.
I can hear you clear now, sir. Seems like we've been losing some signals. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. Yeah, it's clear. Yeah.
Do you think governments are playing a bigger role in the fight against TB and HIV?
Governments?
Do you feel that governments are playing a bigger role now in the fight against HIV and TB?
This question is to...
In general, anyone can answer.
Hello.
So... Everybody can respond. I'll just put in my points of view. Of course, the governments are now playing a more proactive and a bigger play, say, 2-3 decades ago. The governments also, I'm talking particularly in my country, governments also realized that they will not be able to meet all the healthcare costs through tertiary care. So prevention remains the main forte to reduce the manage the health of the population in general, and also to decrease the incidence and prevalence of important diseases of public health importance. So they started investing in public health programs for more than 2 decades ago, and we have seen over the years that in absolute numbers the investments have risen considerably, though as a percentage of GDP, though they have remained more or less constant. But yes, we now see governments playing a more and more bigger proactive role. They also now have taken a leadership role, or so-called seeking private partners in a more proactive way, so that we can address the problems of public health importance in a more holistic way. Others, panelists can add on to this.
Okay. Thank you. Tuyevu Hedula from Namibia has a question to ask. Tuyevu, can you hear me? another
yes, I can hear you. Yes, I can hear you.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So, Sachdeva, please ask the question.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
All right, thank you. My question is, the world is striving towards zero AIDS discrimination. Why is it that some countries ban all foreign HIV-positive individuals from entering their countries? Why is that an exception?
Shobha, I'll add on to this. Well, at policy level, I don't think any country can afford discrimination of any patient, caste, or creed at any level. The situation on grounds may be a bit different in all countries. So, what all programs are doing, they have a specific element of thrust on communication strategy and behavioral change, which focuses on destigmatization, which focuses on treating everybody as equal. The world is also changing very fast. So, having said that, all national programs are working towards creating an environment where there is zero stigma and zero discrimination, though these are deep-rooted in societal beliefs, it will change those systems, but the efforts are ongoing and efforts are increasing towards that end.
Thank you for that hope. Thank you for that hope. I have one question from Dr. Sachdeva. Doctor, you said you mentioned three states in India, J&K, Arunachal Pradesh, and Lakshadweep. What are these high TB-HIV burden states, and what is the main reason for not being able to go there?
Thank you for that. These are not high TB-HIV states. One. And that's also one of the we should not accept that rationalize that's the reason that they are not performing well. But actually, there are very few cases in these states. So having very few cases also means that the health workers in general are not they have not seen such cases. Like Lakshadweep, the population of Lakshadweep is just 60,000. Total. So out of those 60,000, you hardly see 5 or 6 or 10 patients of tuberculosis every year. Of them, TB-HIV they have not seen for many years. So similar is the case with the J&K and Arunachal Pradesh. They are very, very sparsely populated, they are hilly terrains, people live in very difficult circumstances. There is mismatch in the physical infrastructure between the TB program, the HIV program, the testing facilities. People have to walk long distances to avail health services. So these are the things which are somehow attributable to the low rates and ratios in those states. Having said that, the program encourages local non-governmental organizations, local youths, local social workers to come and fill that void. And efforts are ongoing towards that extent, because no amount of work by the government will reach those interventions. Having said that, now HIV program has rolled out new guidelines on HIV testing, which is community-based testing. So now the testing is no more facility-based, it is driven to the communities. So this should also help to increase accessibility to some extent. So does that partially answer the queries which you had? I know it cannot completely answer. I think we lost.
Thank you, Doctor. Well said. I think our panelists made a very strong and passionate plea to many people, especially our young journalists around the world. And we look forward to our AIDS and TB conference that's coming up shortly. And just be tuned to webinar. Of course, we'll bring you up to date as to what's happening in this part of the world. Thank you to Madam Shoba and the expert team, to our leader, Bobby Ramakant, for also making his voice heard during this time. And very, very important that we acknowledge webinar 2016. Thank you to our great panelists.
Thank you everybody, and my regards to Shobha, Bobby, Noma, Fuad, yourself, everybody who's helping to make this webinar successful. Thank you.
Thank you kindly, Doctor.